There are several reasons that the Pope only takes Swiss for the Vatican Guard, which is in fact a real discrimination towards other Catholic people, actually. The first reason is that the first Germanic tribe to collaborate with Rome was the Alemannic tribe to whom the Swiss belong, who speak Swiss German, which is an Alemannic dialect. So the alliance Rome-Switzerland already exists since 2,000 years, and the Vatican is a part of nowadays Rome. Therefore, the Switzerland-Vatican covenant, which is a covenant of hatred and murder, with those Alemannic tribes incorporated in Caesar's army, together murdering the Celts of Europe and even those who lived in the Alps, called the Celtic tribes of the Helvetics. So here you can see, this is the Alps here. They were the first Germanic tribes, and even other maps where you can only see this part here taken by the collaborating with the Romans. Yeah, the Saxons, they were probably the last ones who collaborated with Rome. Therefore, they had to be in the eastern part of Germany under Russian control, because they still don't obey that much compared to the Western Germans like here. So here's Switzerland, the first one who collaborated. That's why the Pope's Guard is Swiss. One of the reasons, actually. There are more. Then after Rome, the Swiss mercenaries continued to murder for the European fair aristocracy, and 1.5 million Swiss mercs did so over 500 years through the Dark Ages, and finally burned all those European women as witches on the stakes for Rome and the Vatican. So this Swiss mercenary period for the king started after the aristocratic Templars founded Switzerland in 1291. And then there's the reason of the pharaohs mixing with the northern European Haunabu sea peoples even before Rome. So this alliance with Rome and the Swiss extends over thousands of years and over at least four periods. So the Alemannic tribes collaborating with Rome betrayed the other Germanic tribes of Europe because they were already mixed with the pharaohs through the early Haunabu period. This is why the Swiss have always been the backstabbers of Europe and the European peoples, and now leading to a successful rise of the extreme right through Swiss emissaries teaching the other European right-wingers to be patient and how to use the democratic structures to gain power over police and army, just as they taught their agent Mr. Hitler. The fantastic results are and democratic successes of the Swiss SVP Nazi Party, showing a dangerous example for the rest of the European right-wingers of how to do it. The Alemans were the first traitors of Northern Europe. That's why the Swiss-Rome alliance still exists through the Pope's Swiss Guard today. The Pope's Guard is both an army and a police force, as it used to be a big army, which is now more like a police force, just as the Swiss mercenaries for the kings were armies against other kings and police forces against its own people at the same time. Yes, the Swiss mercenaries laid the foundations of today's police with their octagon badges, all being part of the Swiss-Rome connection, just as the Pope's Guard. Well, here you can see, they did it for 5 centuries. Well, I mean, this is official. It is much longer, actually. 5 centuries. Right, you can read the whole article. I'll put in the links below the film for you. There we go. Just punch pause. They were very brutal. Extremely brutal. I mean, this is Blackwater and SS to combine together, you know. So here it says, you know, 1.5 million Swiss mercenaries served in foreign armies between the 13th and 19th centuries. Some of them deserted. Well, they stayed there, you know, they integrated and they became the police. 25% to 40 never returned. So they stayed there. That's why I'm telling you, the police, the Octagon Police, are Swiss, first in Europe, in France, in Germany, in Holland, in Spain, everywhere. And then they went to the US and Canada. And there are 1 million Swiss living in the US with a US passport. I'll show it to you later. I mean, this is them. The facts are here. This is them, all right. This is them. They're the ones we're looking for before they come looking for us again. It's amazing the logistics and means of communications they already must have had in those days. Getting 1.5 million Swiss Octagon police mercs over to where they should be and serve some king or aristocrat. And of course, in those days, in the Middle Ages, they couldn't just fly home for the weekend or take a train. And so many got themselves wives, mixed with locals, had offspring and stayed. Or they even had some sisters of Isis from the motherland come over. So 1.5 million men are real many, especially in the Middle Ages, policing the Europeans for the old world order, being the king's knights with an octagon badge, having lots of offspring in their millions, continuing in the king's ranks, slowly transforming into what today we know as the police. And as a fact, many policemen take over the tradition from their fathers, often being in Freemason lodges or others, thus not forgetting where they originate from and who they really are. Coming to the point, why a policeman from your country seems to get better along with a policeman from another country than you and the policeman from your country, with whom you can never have a decent conversation and who seems to be so different from all the other people you know from your country that it is hardly believable that he is a fellow countryman and more feels like another species. The more they ill-treat you, and in the US someone gets shot by them every single day and even gets away with it. And how the entire European police rounded up all the European Jews, their children, and Europe's resistance fighters and handed them over to their Gestapo pals during World War II, lamenting after the war that they didn't have a choice, or they themselves would have been sent into the gas chambers when refusing orders. A plain lie, of course, and nicely premeditated by Octagon or Tavistock. These are the king's men still today, and they have their blue worldwide army over mankind now, and more militarizing, just as in the early days of being the king's army and their police at the same time. Their uniforms are blue with gold-plated badges with octagon shapes, because blue and gold are the colors of the king and the pharaonic royal dignity, just as the mask of King Tut, Tutankhamun. 1.5 million Swiss were the king's police then for the feudal old world order, and they still are today for the new world order, only more hidden, as everything in the new world hidden went into stealth mode. This is why cops kill us, shoot on cardboard targets with our faces on it, and are impossible to have a normal conversation with. They are, in fact, a foreign power in our midst who came from the Alps long ago, and they know it. During the war, the Germans had several police battalions in the Einsatzgruppen, as the Hamburg Police Battalion 101. And they are no Rangers, who never engaged in real bravery and combat against the enemy in battle, but who came behind the real army as a second wave of octagon mass murderers assassinating millions of defenseless civilians in the eastern countries by machine gunning even children and pregnant women in a big sandpit and often bury them alive or half alive and still breathing. And after the war, these policemen went back to work and no one ever asked a single word, just as these Swiss mercenaries were known and renowned for their brutality as rape, drinking blood, and dipping their boots into the belly's fat to impregnate them. And they never stopped doing so, and their descendants are still there today. I mean, who can do this and murder millions of children? Well, only a tradition of thousands of years of mercenaries can. And I know how ruthless the Swiss are towards children and see how they have been terrorizing my children for 17 years. Yeah, read the whole article. I mean, this is police, this is Octagon. These are the descendants of the Swiss mercenaries who were all over Europe and stayed. And they're still the king's knights. The Octagon Blue Army killing us. And it's coming up very soon again. You can feel it coming. And the longer our tormentors continue, the more I see and find out who they really are. As if some ancient universal law has locked me in here, that crime against humanity will not be without some kind of echo. The echo of immense suffering and sorrow, carrying under its wings the intel of how to defeat the beast, where the word is mightier and the universal law will come back at them and stop these monsters and their endless crimes against humanity. There will be a price tag on it this time, waiting for you Swissies. So here we can see, we can read in German, in this from this year, in a German-speaking newspaper, it says, Gewalt passt zur Schweiz, that violence is a part of Switzerland. It's like sort of in their genetic structure, because of thousands of years of mercenary business and killing all over Europe. I mean, this is a known fact, that all the mercenaries, all the mercs, they came from Switzerland. Violence is their thing. It's a part of their character. And especially here in this area where I'm living. And this is going on for 17 years. So this article is in German because it's very hard to find anything about Switzerland because I really tried to seal it all up, you know. There's more coming up in English. So this is in German. It's in their genetics, it says, you know. I can state that. That's true. The lies, the violence, you know, the... Well, here's one more. It says Franz Rudolf Frisching. He was a colonel in the Swiss Guard in Holland, a Swiss merc in Holland, in the Low Countries. They were everywhere. Policemen and army mercenary in 1785. I put the link in the video. So today the Swissie managed to erase another video of mine again, telling us that there is a lot of explosive truth in this video, which they want to hide from mankind. So please everyone copy, download and re-upload with your own titles, so Octagon won't succeed their evil plans and hide their wicked intentions. Long live the US First Amendment. The Europeans didn't want to serve in the king's army that much, neither in the king's military, nor the king's police, which was the same in those days. Most Europeans thought, well, you die in a war, right? So this is why military conscription got installed everywhere after and during the French Revolution of 1790. And before that, the Swiss mercs were the king's killers all over Europe, especially from the 13th till the 19th century, but in reality even much longer when counting the time in the Roman legions, until they invented criminal Nazi banking and the Bank of International Settlements later on. Though immediately in 1291, when the Templars founded their utopia in the Alps, they started to lend money to the European kings, mostly for warfare. And with this wealth accumulated, plus the pillaging of Europe, real Swiss Nazi banking could start in the 19th century, thus officially ending the long tradition of Swiss mercenaries all over Europe. But by then, they were already integrated all over. And here we can witness the Swiss relationship with the nobility and Europe's pharaohs always been serving in the king's army police, who now come and ski in some holiday resort in the Alps, own a few chalets there, and have some safe bank accounts in Octagon of the Nazi Templars. And this is why Switzerland can do as it likes and doesn't have to abide any law, either international nor their own laws, which they don't keep. Thus, the fair aristocracy, old world order and new world order, still showing their gratitude for Octagon's loyal service to nobility's pharaohs, without which the conquest and slavery of the European peoples could never have come true and executed. The Swiss can do what they want and never get punished in their perfect dictatorship, where they enjoy controlling humanity with their banks and bogus Geneva-based NGOs. They enjoy crushing people with their mercenaries as today's Blackwater that provides a real joy to the Swiss heart. And these are the origins of the worldwide Octagon Blue Army against humanity, where spy orcs as the CIA, MI6 or KGB were never assigned against other spy orcs from other countries, as they tell us, but against the people and their own citizens instead. When the kings became masons and the knights became the police, this Octagon army killed and murdered, while they themselves reproduced enormously, while others, as the Jews, Gypsies and European peoples, were exterminated. And this is why they need more and more taxpayers' money, for more and more police, because they have so many descendants now, who also need a job and don't want to work a single day. They use false flags, ops, and the media to attain this goal and parasite upon humanity, with the king's worldwide blue Octagon army of Swiss origins. And now, in fact, the whole world has a universal Swiss Pope's Guard roaming the streets looking for victims whom they can handcuff, or even worse. By the way, not paying taxes is illegal, and you go to prison for it if you don't pay any taxes. Under one exception, if you don't have any money and you don't have any income, then you can't pay any taxes. So me, Sean Ross, of this video, I have no income, so I don't pay any taxes. I don't have to have a bad conscience. There's no cops' wages I pay, no wars I finance. So the best thing is, you know, don't do anything anymore. I wanted to work here. They didn't give me a working permit. They terrorized me. And now it's okay, yeah. So I don't work. I have no income. So I can't pay any taxes. So well, suit yourself, you know. And when in 1792, during the French Revolution, the French found out they were being terrorized by a foreign power from the Alps, serving the French nobility, the French massacred a Swiss regiment in Les Tuileries, for which the Swiss still have monuments in the motherland to remember this. So, of course, these fine words about the Swiss, well, they are words by themselves, of course, with an American writing. So this is probably the sleeper agents in the United States writing down this, eh? The Octagon Fifth Column in the US. I mean, nobody else, no French person would write this, eh? So, Lettieri, 10th of August, 1792. Then, right after that, an enormous Swiss wave of terror descended upon the French called La Terreur, just chopping people's heads off randomly with guillotines. And the French Revolution started anyway in 1789 with the storming of La Bastille, because Octogon's mercenary from Switzerland were torturing and holding French citizens prisoner in the dungeons of La Bastille. So up to this day, Octogon doesn't like the French very much, because they can be very unpredictable and rise up to their masters. So this is why France is being kept in semi-chaos with mass immigration for divide and rule. The Swiss mercs have always been the king's killers, even up to today, explaining why US cops shoot so many defenseless people. In fact, Switzerland is the most unneutral country in the entire world, and they call the mercenary business a Reislauf, from the German Reisen und Laufen, to travel and to walk. Leading to the slogan of the French Foreign Legion, Marche ou Crève, which is from the Swiss Reislauf, to travel and to walk, because the French Foreign Legion was founded by the Swiss and for the Swiss. I'll explain it to you later. And just as the Nazis literally went into big business after the war and all taking leading CEO positions in big German Nazi companies, who all involved into crimes against humanity during the World War II, similar when the Swiss mercs business seemingly stopped, they all went into huge banking business just as the Nazis, well, who were financed by the Swiss in the first place. So, well, it's always the same with those sect leaders. They are filthy rich, and their followers, they die poor. It's just another sect. All mercenary companies are of Swiss origins by their fifth column sleeper agents, and even the French Foreign Legion is in fact Swiss, and founded by the Swiss for the Octogon mercenaries in the first place, in a time where Swiss merc business seemingly stopped, well, only because they went into an even more stealth mode. Where it says in a bit weird English, the first commander of the Foreign Legion was the Swiss Christoph Anton Stoffel from Arbonne. And there's some more here. This is about the Foreign Legion. Here's some more about the first commander of the tough Swiss veteran Colonel Stoffel. It's all Swiss, you know. Well, some more about the guy. It says in German, he was the first commander of the French Foreign Legion, a Swiss officer. And he was a Baron. Von Stoffel, a Baron. The Red Baron. Swiss. It was founded by the Swiss. I'll tell you more about it. Here's some more in German. The first commander of the French Foreign Legion was the guy from Thurgau, the Colonel Oberst Baron Christoph von Stoffel from Arbonne. So it was Swiss. I mean, the whole mercenary business was Swiss. So of course the French Foreign Legion became Swiss, was founded by the Swiss. Well, and it still is. It still belongs to the Swiss. Believe me. Well, here's some more Swiss commanders in the French Foreign Legion. They don't even talk about soldiers. There must have been real many. He was a general, and the the commandant of Lyon, a Swiss guy from Bern. And another one. Even afterwards he went into the Swiss army, a captain. This one here. And here's another one. Well, there's loads of them. This guy, the commander of the Swiss during the Second World War. He even said, well, go into the French Foreign Legion and then come back and we'll take you in the Swiss army. Oh, man. Just like the Pope's Guard, like what they say. Yeah. Well, it's all Swiss. It's another Pope's Guard, like. Yeah. The French Legion was founded in 1831. Here we can see it, March 10th, 1831. Shortly after the French Revolution, their first commandant was a Swiss called Christoph Anton Stoffel, von Stoffel, from Thurgau, who immediately put 10,000 Swiss mercenaries into the Swiss Foreign Legion from France. Now, how did this happen? Here we can see that it was founded. It was founded by the French King Louis Philippe on March 10th, 1831. So here again about the French Foreign Legion in Wikipedia. Here the history. It says it was created by Louis Philippe, who spent 20 years in Switzerland and only 6 months after he was in charge, being the King of France, he installed the French Foreign Legion, or the Swiss Foreign Legion, and put a Swiss colonel, von Stoffel, at the head of it in 1831, March the 10th. And I think it was the August 9th, 1830 when he came into power. And if you look at the songs in the Legion, things, you know, where is it? These slow songs they sing. It says pour les Alsaciens, les Suisses et les Lorrains. So that would be, they only sing for these three here. In English, that's the chorus. It says, here. For the Alsatians, well, they speak Swiss German in France. That's the eastern part of Switzerland, and they became they murdered the Swiss mercenaries. They murdered all the original Gallo-Romanic inhabitants of Alsace in the 30-year war, and then the Swiss, they all settled down. So that's why they speak Swiss German. As Alsace, it means all Swiss. Al-Suisse. So it's only for the Alsatians, who are Swiss, and the Swiss. Remember the guy from the Auschwitz concentration camps I once filmed. Well, YouTube took it off immediately. He was of Swiss descent. He even knew it at 350 years ago. And so Alsatian, that's where they speak German. There are two German dialects, Germanic dialects in France. Here they speak Alemannic, as in Switzerland. And in Lorraine, they speak a Frankish dialect. So it's only for the Germanic or German-speaking peoples and the Swiss. Because it's all Swiss. It's Swiss mercenary business made by the Swiss. And with the Swiss colonel in the beginning, the French king. It is Swiss. They always were the mercenaries, and even here in their songs it says, and it says, for the Belgians there's none left, they're lazy shirkers. whatever that is. And, well, they don't like the Belgians. But all the Alemannic people, the Swiss, well, they are okay. Probably part of the Swiss discrimination. This one is good. Well, me, Sean Ross, I'm not good. So I'm probably part of the Belgians. There's none left. I'm a lazy shirker. Well, I'm working very hard on my videos. It's the only thing is I can't get out of the house, and they didn't give me a working permit. So, I mean, how can I work? And if they put me in a prison, how can I work? Well, I am working. I'm just not getting any money for it. Well, anyway, okay. Hey, Swissies. The French king Louis-Philippe I, who ruled France from 1830 to 1848, well, here we can see that, August 9th, 1830, remember the French Legion in March 1831, so only 6 months later, after he was in reign. Well, it reminds me of Herbert Hoover, 6 months later, no, was it 4 months later or 3 months later, he founded the Bank of International Settlements was founded, or after the Black Tuesday, you know. So he was 1830, so he had to go into exile because of the French Revolution, and later on because of Napoleon. Now, where do you think he went into exile? Oh yes, Switzerland, of course, where his loyal king's killers and Octagon's mercenaries brought him to, where he stayed in exile more than 20 years, from 1793 to 1815, the year of Napoleon's defeat of Waterloo, upon which the Swiss annexed large part of eastern France, of the Jura Mountains, until this very day. So over these 20 years, the future French king and Octagon had plenty of time to talk, conspire, and make unholy alliances, which was beyond doubt the very reason they made him king of France anyway. So, yeah, it says the exile here, 20 years. He went to Zurich, and he went to Switzerland, and Swiss neutrality, he went to Basel here, again Switzerland, and he was all over Switzerland for 20 years, the French king, and the first Schaffhausen, everywhere. So it's concluded with the Swissies, the very first thing he did when coming into power on August 9th, 1830, was a few months later, on March 10th, 1831, install an army inside France for his loyal Swiss Octagon pals and Swiss mercenaries, called the French Foreign Legion, to control the people of France with a foreign power until this very day. And he put the Swiss Colonel von Stoffel at the head. And in fact, only this explains why France was divided into two parts during World War II with that Vichy regime by the traitor Marshal Pétain, who was undoubtedly of Swiss origins and a descendant of Octagon's mercs and the king's killers ruling over the French. And that's why in 1944 he tried to escape too, and well, he did escape too. Well, yes, Switzerland. Here it says Pétain, Swiss. Here he is, the traitor. And this is in a Swiss newspaper of Neuchâtel. I went filming there, filming the sword of the Shriners, remember? So this is April the 26th, 1945. always Switzerland. They always go there where they think they're safe, and most of the time they are. Well, there it is again. In English, Pétain escapes to Switzerland in 1945. Well, back to the motherland, hey? Just another one of those Swiss mercs, still today, betraying the French people. So this is why the French, they lose all their battles and all their wars, because they've been betrayed from the beginning. And this has been going on for hundreds of years. It started with the Swiss mercs for the French kings. I showed it to you. And the French king, that he founded the French Foreign Legion with the Swiss colonel, with the first commandant of the le commandant du Légion étrangère. Well, it's all Swiss. The merc business has always been Swiss, and it always will be Swiss. I already showed you that Blackwater is Swiss, that the South African mercs, they came from Holland. They were not Dutch, they were Swiss mercs for the Dutch king. It's all Swiss. The whole police business, all the wars, the army, the SS, it's Swiss, believe me. So here's some information about military conscription, which dates back to the French Revolution in 1790. So that's just about 40 years before the French Foreign Legion. So because of the conscription coming up all over Europe, that was the end of the official, and the end of the kings, you know, the revolutions all everywhere, and it was the end of the official, Swiss mercenaries. So that's why they had to hide even more. In for the next French king, when Napoleon was gone, so this Louis Philippe, who came into power in 1830, so that's 40 years after the beginning of conscription, in a sort of a hidden way into a French, well, Swiss, foreign legion. So this is very much related to the conscription coming up. And even the British Empire, you know, again the kings, the aristocracy, and even the British Empire had Swiss mercenaries in the British Swiss Legion of at least 2,200 men, who were supposed to go and fight in the Crimean War in 1855. Not very long, 15 years after the, or 25 years after the creation of the French Foreign Legion. Because the Swiss have a large fifth column and Swiss settlers in the Crimea and the Ukraine. Now look at that, the octagon from Octagon. Now doesn't that sound utterly awakening and ringing some bells concerning today's actualities in the Ukraine, World War III building up, and Swiss President Didier Burkhalter being sent there all the time to talk with Mr. Putin, making secret plans against humanity. Here we can see the Swiss cross here, like on the Swiss flag, the Templars thing, which we can see on Alex Jones's little bottles he's selling. Oh, there it is. I'll put in the links for you. Oh, there's some more. The British Swiss Legion, an octagon, and the same Alex Jones Swiss cross. Wow. There's some more. The British Swiss Legion. Oh, and they're still there. Maybe they were partly the SAS killing Irish people, eh? They didn't leave. Couldn't take an airplane those days, see? The octagon, here the octagon. British Swiss Legion, for whom? Well, for the crown, with the Templar's cross on it. Oh. Well, they were everywhere. Each king, every aristocrat, had a at the Swiss Legion, Swiss mercenaries. A colonel at the Swiss artillery school in Bienne. It's really a lot. They are the war makers. They never stopped. You think they just stopped it after thousands of years? Well, come on. Of course they didn't. They're into killing business. Very brutal. No mercy. That's why they like to have them, the Swissies, huh? Now you see this Swiss aristocrat and colonel or general, he was in Ireland, he was in India. It wasn't even, maybe not even the English killing the Irish and their children. They're the ones who always did it. All these wars. The Swiss are everywhere, installing fifth column sleeper agents and go for the key positions in Russia, Crimea, Ukraine, Brazil, Uruguay, Hungary, Bessarabia, France, the US, Germany, etc., etc. And having their non-really integrating Nueva Helvetia, Pequeña Suizas communities everywhere. Here you can see, in America, in the US, there's almost 1 million of them. Of whom they know they are of Swiss descent. There's probably 5 or 6, or even more. In Canada, 150,000. Well, etc., etc. Argentina, 300,000. Brazil. They're everywhere. In Europe, in France. Total of worldwide 7 million. 2 million in, they call it the diaspora. And they came everywhere. But if you want to go into Switzerland, oh man, they come with their racist SVP Nazi party, and they treat you as a subhuman, arrest you all the time, and well, that's Switzerland, eh? So this is Swiss humor. Look, somebody puts a knife in the in the bicycle of my youngest son here. It's through both sides. Nice, eh? So this is a knife in the tire at the side. It's a bit older now because it's been done already some time ago. And this is the part which doesn't touch the street. Now, this here is the part that touches the street, and it's still a new tire. So, some funny Swiss terrorists, they put a knife in it here. Maybe the guys who are constructing it next door. Well, this is Switzerland. A bunch of very sneaky, lying, and hateful people. That's Switzerland. My youngest son. So this website is called Swiss People on Wikipedia. Yeah, they're even in Vietnam, in Asia, everywhere. Taking over societies. They don't change, look. They don't change, they don't integrate. They're talking about foreigners, Swiss diaspora. They're talking about immigrants in Switzerland. Oh, they have to integrate. Well, they don't mean integrate, they mean obey everything which we tell you. But they, here, even in Russia, in Bessarabia, in the Ukraine, and in the Crimea, well, I'll show it to you later. In Singapore, Sri Lanka, of course the United States, So this is just the tip of the iceberg. I mean, 2 million officially. I mean, that's only the last 100 years, maybe, but there must be. I don't know, 20 million worldwide. And Octagon is ruling the world, I tell you. So about the subject of Swiss immigration, it says here, ausgewandert, in sieben Jahrhunderten, over 7 centuries, it means emigrated, they're all Swiss. And this is a book from this year, 2014. They know it. They're everywhere. I haven't read it yet, you know, so. So 7 centuries, the 700 years ago, there was, what, I mean, since Switzerland was founded by the Templars, and it all started, like. Yeah. So this is a new book. I haven't read it yet. So. They know it, and they're proud of it, everywhere. And if you come here, in this country, oh man, they treat you so bad. And here, look, they're smiling, you know, oh yeah, they were well treated, you know. Yeah. The Octagon suitcase. Domination of the world in there. Yeah, look, Swiss emigration to Russia, number 50,000. Well, it's probably more in the 18th century. They went to Bessarabia. Well, Bessarabia, that's the southern part of the Ukraine, and a part of Moldavia as well. They went to the Russian Empire. They're everywhere. I think Putin, he's very likely to be Swiss, because they take all the key positions. That's why he gets along so well with the Swiss president, Didier Burkhalter. Maybe they speak like the Korean guy, Kim Jong-un. Maybe they even speak Swiss-German together. I would not be surprised at all. The chances are very, very high. These are the ones behind it all. Yeah. So this is in Wikipedia. I put it in the links under the film. Swiss diaspora, the Swiss Americans. Well, I already showed you this in some of my other films, so I'm not going to repeat this. I told you about Germany and yeah. I don't know if this is true, that Putin's father fought for the Nazis. Well, it looks like Putin, but that would explain a lot. That Putin is like a Cossack, I think, in the Nazi uniform. That Putin is talking with the Swiss president of Octagon, and he liberated the oligarch Khodorkovsky, and all these sort of things, you know. I mean, if this is true, then he is Octagon, which I think he is. I mean, you won't become president or a prime minister if you're not part of the gang. It simply doesn't happen, right? They just want the Russians to die, the ordinary people, they want the Americans to die, and every time we become more and more stupid, the best people, they die, and there's no more, like, hey, son, life is about like this and this and this. So we're getting more and more stupid, and we're getting, like, raised by TV and the mainstream media and Tavistock, you know. There's the rest of the story. I'll put it in the link for you. As a historian, I can't verify this if it's true. The rest is true. The rest is history. There are facts. This I don't know. But it might explain a lot, if not everything. And of course, if he's Octagon fighting for the Germans and all that, I mean, Putin is Swiss. That's why the Ukrainian war for the Swiss colonies in the Crimea, Bessarabia, and in the Ukraine. The Zurich Valley and all this, it explains everything. talking with the Swiss president and taking his orders. So here's Bessarabia. Well, it's not in Arabia, it's in Europe. It probably has, it has to do with the Ottoman Empire. So here's the Ukraine, the Crimea. I showed it to you too. The Swiss emigrated here as well. This is Romania, Moldavia as well. So this is Bessarabia. So no wonder, I mean, this oligarch Yanukovych, a former president and a criminal of the Ukraine, he had a Swiss chalet. Yeah, and all the workers there, they were Swiss and they all spoke German. Well, he's one of them. They went to Bessarabia, they went to Russia, the Ukraine, everywhere. I'm showing it to you, it's all in the internet. Believe me. So this is Bessarabia. Well, I put in the links as well. It's interesting, very interesting. It's about the Dutch people and the Scythian people as well. And well, here's some more colony in, they call it the Zurich Valley, Zurichtal, by Swiss immigrants. And so the whole Ukraine war, it's about the Swiss, believe me. They done it, just as they financed Adolf Hitler. They behind it. And Zurich and Mr. Putin, he's one of them. Very, very likely he's one of them. So here it says, to emigrate from Switzerland to the Crimean Peninsula. I mean, the thing in the voting and the war in the Crimea, it's about the Swiss. They're probably, I don't know, maybe hundreds of thousands must be there. And this is what it's about. And if they don't get what they want, well, they're gonna give us another world war, I tell you. They're working on the third world war. And they did the first and the 30-year war. They're all over in it. So the Ukrainian problems, oh, they're Swiss made, just like the rest. I'll put it in the links, of course. Now, some Swiss houses there. Oh, what do you know, eh? Whoa, man. They even changed their names from Ila into Yagovlevna. Well, that sounds Russian, doesn't it? Hey, so you don't see that. So, you know, it's not that obvious anymore. They're gone. This is what a fifth column is like. And as I've already shown you in my other films about the fifth column in America, they call themselves the Swiss diaspora, the Auslandschweizer. The fifth Switzerland. This is where the word the fifth column is from. The sleep agents. I mean, they even made the word, you know, fifth column. I mean, nobody understands it, you know, why in those days, now everybody does, or most of the people. But in the beginning, the fifth column or the fifth Switzerland, who knew what it meant? This is in German, the Krim, the Swiss, Schweizer, Zurich, Zurichtal. Well, you can all read it yourself. I mean, these are solid proofs. They are everywhere. I put in the links for... Oh, this is going too fast. Yeah, they're everywhere. Okay. Right, here's some more about the Swiss in Russia. Crimea in German. Well, did you know this, Mr. Putin? Well, I bet you do, eh? You're one of them. Going for the key positions, like Eisenhower, like Herbert Hoover, like gay Edgar Hoover. General Custer is all Swiss. This is Octagon ruling the world. Jetzt Schweizer Wurzeln kaum mehr sichtbar. The Swiss roots are invisible. I bet they are. It says, Schabo, ein Schweizer Kolonie, a Swiss colony in Bessarabia. And again, you know, don't try and come here. You know, they treat you so bad. While they are everywhere in the world. And taking key positions, making wars, financing wars, Swiss banking, Nazis. The Ukrainian Nazis, whom they are talking about, they are Swiss, believe it. Hey, Mr. Putin, the State Department, if you don't know it, have a look at this. Here's some more about the Swiss in the Ukraine. And it says, it means they disappeared, you know, they became invisible, you see. I put in the link. Now there's even some Swiss with a Twicky, Vladimir Twicky. Well, here's some more. The Vladimir, a Russian name, Twicky. You know, the name is still Swiss. It says they disappeared. Well, I bet they disappeared, you know. There's even an email here. They are the Nazis of the Ukraine, believe me. They're the Nazis in Europe. And before we all kill each other again and another world war. So I hope some people look at this here. So we can stop it. And get the real guilty ones. You know. Well, I put in the link, so you just read it yourself. This is in German. Of course, there's a lot more in German, because, I mean, that's their language. And even the Swissies who speak French or Italian, they are Swiss Germans. I mean, look at the phone book. They're all Swiss German names. Well, I bet you won't find any more Swiss German names, or they probably changed them in the Crimea. They are the ones behind the turmoils in the Ukraine. Believe me, the Swiss banks are going down. They have billions to pay to the Americans, and they're going to take them all down, the IRS. This time they're doing a good job, the IRS and the NSA, because it needs the NSA, you know, because it's the most invisible crime of all, the financial crime. And this here, what the Swiss are doing. So, I don't like governments, I don't like police, I don't, you know, but only the NSA can look behind the screens. And so I hope they're watching this. Well, all Swiss names here, you know, some of them. Yeah, so these are the ones behind it. I'll put this in the links for you as well. Alright, just put in the links everywhere. Well, this is it says Swiss colonies in Hungary. Wow, also in Hungary. And you remember the Nazi party in Hungary during the war, killing all the Jews and giving it to the Nazis. They call them the Pfeilspitzler, these guys with an arrow. And now the rise of fascism in Hungary. That's enormous. They even have concentration camps again, you know. The Swiss winter. I can even show it to you. It was in the newspaper. The Swiss Nazi Party, the SVP Nazi Party, they went there a couple of weeks ago to the Hungarian concentration camps. Now, in 2014, Nazis now in Hungary, Nazis then. Well, they're the ones behind it. It's all Swiss. You know it if you live here. You know, I've been here for 70 years. I know how they... I've never seen so much hatred in my whole life. I've never seen so much evil, so many lies, and so organized. So much Nazism and fascism and evil. It's pure evil. I know them now, and they're everywhere. Yeah, look, the Swiss in Brazil. Well, they look very Brazilian, don't they? Huh? Helvetia everywhere in Sao Paulo, a Swiss colony in Sao Paulo. Well, it's the biggest town in Brazil, I think it is. I'll put in the links, read it yourself. Of course, there's, as I told you, there's more in German. And everywhere. Well, Swiss colony in Uruguay. Yeah, look, this is 2014, it says. Well, of course, Uruguay. That's where Klaus Barbie, the butcher of Lyon, of the Gestapo. That's where he went to, didn't he? To Uruguay. It's full of Nazis. Now, I already showed you about Argentina and even the president, Kirchner, that they are Swiss, of Swiss descent, and the rest in the US. Well, they are the ones, you know, they are destroying our earth, all these wars. They are the ones, believe me. They are the ones who are everywhere. And they don't integrate, look. They don't integrate, look at them, in Uruguay. Everywhere, Nueva Helvetia, Colonia Suiza, Pequeña Suiza, all over. In Africa, Swiss colonies in Africa. Well, these guys are everywhere. I already told you about South Africa, how the Swiss mercs, they went to the Low Countries, worked for the king, killed some cloggies there, and they were the ones who went to South Africa. And now they're killing Iraq, they're killing Afghanistan. South African mercs are already in the Ukraine, but they are Swiss. And they know it. They know it. Blackwater, eh? From Schwarzwasser in Bern with the bare feet. Well, read it yourself. Well, this is also in German. But I mean, you can all read this here. Swiss colony, Schweizer colony, yeah? Africa. Well, if an African comes to Switzerland, well, they kill him. You know, they just lie things together. I'm an African. They lie things together to put you in prison, you know, for nothing. I spent 1 year in prison, in a high security prison, a political prisoner, for nothing. They lie things together, you know, and there are 14,000 immigrants that have disappeared here the last few years. They disappeared. Huh. Incinerated, like in an oven, I tell you. And in 1763, the Swiss mercenary colonel Louis-Henri Fourgeau knocked down a slave uprising in Holland. Well, I told you, the slave trader ships, they were the Templar ships of Switzerland. They owned them. I already told you in some of my other films. And he was the head of the King's Killers for the Dutch nobility, whose regiment, De Meuron, was sent to Cape Town later on in 1783. As I've already explained to you in my other films, how the notorious South African mercs are in fact not Dutch or real Boers, but they are real Swiss octagon. And they are the real white men killers doing so, even against the white race itself. They are the biggest killers of Europe, and all the world's polices and armies still work for the king and pharaoh's nobility. It says, from Geneva, where all the so-called NGOs, peace organizations are from, the United Nations, the Red Cross and all the rest, you know. So he was a colonel, Louis-Henri Fourgeau. He knocked down the slaves in Holland, yeah, Niederschlagung, he knocked them all down. So, giving the Dutch people a bad name, who had in fact nothing at all to do with slavery. It was all Swiss, except for this so-called Dutch aristocracy or a bunch of pharaohs anyway. So it's the pharaohs and octagon. Well, I mean, octagon was founded by the Templars, who are of aristocratic origin. They were no monks. those Templars. So they just go to another country and do it over there. So Switzerland can keep its neutrality swindle clean and neutral and innocent face, you know. The sound of money. It's not the sound of music, but the sound of money. Even in Finland, during the 1939 Finnish-Russian Winter War, Octogon's emissary, Colonel and Swiss Senator Henri Valoton, was sent to spy and learn what was going on, his presence leading to the burning of northern Finland by the Nazis later on. And no Finnish names at all present on key positions in the Finnish army. Marshal Freiherr von Mannerheim, Swiss-German aristocracy. General Ostermann, a Swiss-German name. General Usch, of Swiss-German descent. And General Okvist, Swedish name, for which they were called the three O's, their names starting with an O. The O of Octagon and the O as a circle and three rings of power of the Vesica Pichas and the Holy Trinity of Isis, Horus and Seth. So this is the book I have. This is, you see the sash, the pharaonic sash he's having there, like the pharaohs and all the aristocrats. So this was the head of the Finnish forces. Freiherr von Mannerheim. Well, what a Finnish name, eh? Yeah, von Mannerheim. They even wrote this for the Swissy. I guess that's an octagon, isn't it? Well, anyway, there's the Templar's cross. So this was the book. The book is from 1940 as well. So this guy was a senator and a Swiss colonel. Yeah, in Zurich. Now the book is from 1940, Zurich. And this guy, he went and spy for Octagon in Finland, in Suomi. Well, there he is with the other Octagon members. Not very typical Finnish name, Usch. He's, at least his parents are Swiss. Ostermann is a Swiss name, they call him the three O's. You see here? Den drei O. Well, there they are. Seeing his pals up there. So that's all from the book. And I mean, we die. The Finnish people die, the Russian soldiers die, and they just say, well, you go and fight them, kill the other ones. And what a stupid thing anyway, to give an order to kill somebody else. That's a stupid thing to do, isn't it? So here it says that the author of the book is here, so probably this guy here. He looked like a Gestapo agent. He probably was later on. And so that was during the Winter War. And this sort of neutral country goes to see when where the wars are and spy. Well, that's not a very neutral thing to do, is it? Well, it would be interesting for Finnish people to put these pictures in the in Google. I don't know how to do that. So maybe nobody knows them, these pictures here in Finland, because they are Swiss pictures. So that's von Mannerheim, Freiherr. Aristocracy, the pharaohs. We die, we shoot, we bleed, and they just eat and give the orders. Some more, the Winter War in 1939-1940. The Russians, they suffered very high losses. And history says that the Ruskies, they lost this war. Well, I say the Faroes had just had to get rid of a couple of Ruskies before the war with the Germans started. That's what it was all about. That's the Horus Matrix. I mean, how can Finland win over Russia? That's the same myth as Switzerland was too strong for the Germans to take, while Switzerland had five tanks at the beginning of the war and the Germans had 75,000 or something. It's just another lie. Though the Finnish are like real good fighters, apparently, and they did military service. They learned it all in the Russian army anyway. That was part of Russia before. They got taught by the Russians. It's the same with the and in the Russian and the Prussian army as well, the Finnish. Well, there's some more. It's an interesting book. I was lucky to get it. Probably one of the last ones around here, and it gives a deep inside picture, you know, what Octagon is really doing. Well, it must have been a terrible war, though. You know, it's not the other soldier, the enemy, but also the snow and the weather conditions. It's probably the hardest conditions to fight. Like desert warfare, jungle warfare, and polar warfare. Well, this is the hardest. I hope my Finnish friends, from YouTube, they enjoy the pictures of their ancestors. So this guy, a general commander of the Finnish army, he's Swiss. Look at him, he's Swiss. And the author even knows it, that the Templar's cross. He puts a signature on it. And yeah, Lennart Oesch. Oesch is a Swiss name. Here it says, "Der Abstammung nach ein Schweizer," which is the same thing Wikipedia says. So, what's a Swiss general like doing in the Finnish army? Oh, there's Octagon. They're everywhere, even in Finland. They have Swiss colonies. That reminds me of the Falklands. Yeah, some more Falklands. Yeah, well, they're Russians. They just told them, "Well, you go there, you go there." So they died, you know. You must be stupid taking orders, you know. The only orders I take is my conscience, and that's it. No orders. But the Finnish population, they must have been real scared. Russian army standing at their borders. But the headship never even wanted to take Finland. If they would have wanted, they would have done it. If the Faroes would have wanted to take Finland, then it would have happened. But it was not in their plans. That's funny, me being a South African with a very rare book, a Swiss book, showing pictures of the Finnish Russian Winter War, which probably no Finn even has. Was that Helsinki? Well, it's destiny, eh? Well, Red Cross. What's that? Swastika on it. Jeez. some swastika thing for a nurse in the Finnish war. Well, that's weird. Should analyze this. The swastika Red Cross knife in the Finnish-Russian Winter War. Well, it says General Lennart Usch, a general in the during the Winter War and of the Finnish Army, and he was born to parents of Swiss origin. It says this is Octagon. Yeah. Here they would never give a in Switzerland they would never give an immigrant such a high position. Yeah. Only to the Swiss. And later on, I mean, these guys, they invited the Nazis in Finland. Yeah. So that's in Wikipedia. Put in the links for you. Here's the other one, Ulquist, the other one of the three O's. He got trained in the Royal Prussian Army, the 27th Jäger Battalion, against the English, against the Americans, against the French. So, well, this is a Swedish name. There are no Finnish names in the. Among the Finnish officers. Well, this is the Lodge of the Nine Sisters, Les Neuf Sœurs, which I also filmed here in Bern. And after I uploaded it, they took off the name from the doors very quickly. And they were found established in Paris in 1776. And this is the year of the Declaration of Independence. And also when the Illuminati were founded in Ingolstadt in Bavaria by Adam Weishaupt. And I tell you, these ones are far, far more dangerous than the Illuminati. They gave the Statue of Liberty, the ISIS, to the Americans. Or to the ones, the pharaohs leading America, rather. I'd rather say. Very dangerous lodge. Also called the Nine Sisters of Voltaire. Remember in France this year I filmed the Nine Obelisks in France. This one is also from France. The most dangerous lodge in the world, I'd say. So this is the book. Looks very old. It's very interesting. All yellow and smells. It's a miracle it survived. It survived a some water flooding and a lot of other things, you know. It's still there. That must have been like that. Don't you think it's a coincidence? This book has a lion. Yeah? This is the symbol of the aristocracy and royal dignity of the pharaoh. The book's cover is in blue and gold as lapis lazuli on King Tut's royal mask, or the blue uniform of Octagon's worldwide blue army with a gold octagon badge pinned on it. Also showing nine pentagram flowers as in the Lodge of the Nine Circles and Lodge of the Nine Sisters, plus the Muslim round sword Hanjar. Here it is. Of the Shriners and the Hanjar SS Division, and filmed in Octagon in my Neuchâtel video. All in all, in a coat of arms, here it is, like on the Swiss Army knife. And why does it have two swords? One Templar sword, or the Crusader sword, and one Muslim sword. Well, that means the pharaohs here, this is the pharaoh, the lion, the symbol of the aristocracy with the crown, and so it means They controlled both sides, the Crusaders, and they controlled the Muslims, you know, the Hashashin and the Templars. This is what they always do. And we have to die. And they don't. They get more and more power. And we get more and more stupid as a farmed race. Well, this is Octagon, the heart of evil, the hidden enemy of mankind with their sealed lips of conspiracy and secret smiles. Well, don't you think twice that this colonel doesn't know what he's doing and that he's not part of the aristocracy of the pharaohs of Octagon. Well, don't you think that for a minute. I repeat, this is Octagon, the heart of evil, the hidden enemy of mankind with the sealed lips of conspiracy and secret smiles.